Hello, I'm Ayush Kaushal. I will be talking about natural language processing in Julia. I'm a computer science student at Indian Institute of Technology, Kharagpur. I have contributions to word tokenizers, text analysis, and corpus loaders packages. Last Google Summer of Code, I worked on named entity recognition and part of speech model using Flux and Julia text packages. Before we begin, I would like to thank Oxenabox and Avix for mentoring me in GSOC last year and to Google Open Source for funding. The packages which I will discuss is work of 30 plus contributors. And before we begin, I will be using NLP as this is the acronym for natural language processing throughout the talk. Natural languages like English and Spanish are easy for humans to understand. Artificial languages like Julia and C++ have been designed so that computers find it easy to understand those. On the other hand, natural languages are a bit difficult for computers to understand. And that is what this field is about, getting them to read, write, and understand natural languages. NLP is hard. One reason is ambiguity. Consider this sentence. It could have at least three different meanings. One could be, I used my magic wand and turned her into a duck. Or, I threw something at her and that made her duck. Or, I cooked a duck for her. Coreference. Hey, there are two people, Bill and John, and one pronoun. In order to understand this sentence, we will have to reason what this pronoun refer to. Which person does this pronoun refer to? Next is common sense and context. From common sense, we know that in our daily life, it is a little uncommon for people to be using magic to turn people into ducks. And from context of wizards or some movies related to magicians, this may not seem so absurd. And since vocabulary can be very large and also new words can be created from the existing words, as humans we can infer the meaning of new word from the existing words in some cases. Consider this example. Here, with the prefix un, from the word fathomable, we will be able to infer that this means something that is not fathomable. Computers find it a bit difficult to do this. Next, why should we care about NLP? First reason is applications like spam filters, automated email suggestions, machine translation, classification. Also, at some point of time, we would hope that computers are smart enough so that we'll be able to communicate to them in our own natural languages, something which we are comfortable in. This talk will mainly be about Julia text packages and how they fit in for you to build deep learning pipelines for natural language processing in Julia, though the packages will also be useful for statistical techniques. Here's the outline. First, we pick up the task of sentiment classification, and I'll quickly go over NLP pipeline and discuss various packages. And then we'll discuss some other tasks and pipelines, and finally, little bit into statistical tokenizers and transformers. Now let's discuss the task. Sentiment analysis task is to detect the polarity of text, whether it's a positive or negative sentiment. This is difficult because we cannot just look at individual words such as funny and enjoyable. Here both correspond to positive sentiment, but due to negation, this sentence overall becomes a negative sentiment. This task can find use cases. Suppose you are in a company which receives a large number of complaints or user reviews. You can sort them based on sentiment and look at the most negative ones first. Or you can just sort your JuliaCon talks feedbacks and look at only the positive feedbacks. And this can be performed at document level and sentence level. And in this talk, we'll be discussed mainly on sentence or phrase level. Here is how our pipeline looks like. First, we have to talk about how we'll get the data sets. Here, I'll quickly go over corpus loaders. And then I'll go a little bit into detail with word tokenizers and its APIs. Then onto word embeddings, and then neural networks using Flux. Let's start with data sets now. Corpusloaders.jl. This package provides with various commonly used NLP corpora and data sets. And here are some of the features. First, it uses data depths for managing downloads and easy replicability. And since in NLP, we often work with list of list as in list of corpus where each corpus is a list of document, which is a list of paragraphs and then a list of sentences, words and characters. So we would be interested in working at different resolution depending on your interest. Here multi-resolution iterators comes in handy. In case of large corpora, we may want lazy loading. And since the same string can repeat and again in a dataset, this package uses intern strings. Last summer, a fellow JSOC student added these three sentiment dataset. So, yes, Yash Patil added these three sentiment datasets, which we'll be using in this. Let's go over one example, IMDb reviews dataset. So first, what this dataset is about, it contains reviews. So each review is a document where a document can consist of multiple sentences and each document has been assigned a sentiment polarity. Now we start with loading the packages and then we load the dataset. Here DataDebs manages the download. It'll see if this package is present locally or not. If not, then it'll ask your permission to download it. Here we lazily load only two such documents. And next, if we want to work at sentence level, so we can flatten it about document level to get a list of sentences. So two documents flatten into 19 sentences now. Moving on to tokenization stage, word tokenizers. Here is what Wikipedia says about tokenization. What machine gets as input is a string or a sequence of characters. But when we are reading the text, we often divide it into various chunks or units, or which can be words or punctuations or even subword at times. Or in case of when we are reading tweets, we may treat entire URL or username or hashtag as one particular entity. A little bit into types of tokenization, sentence level. Since we can be working on various document level, and first we'll have to do sentence level splitting. And here's one example for that. Then word level. So the tokenizers for word level tokenization assume that sentence level tokenization has already been done. And next would be subword level, which also consider prefixes, roots and suffixes. Let's discuss about word tokenizers now. Now let's go over the various APIs that word tokenizers provide. These notebooks are uploaded at this URL. We start with loading the package. First, we start with sentence splitters and segmenters. As of now, word tokenizers has one sentence splitter. This is a rule based with large list of exceptions. Now consider this text. It has three sentences. The first one is from here to here, and then second one, and then third one. Let's see how split sentences does on this sentence. And it is able to split correctly about all the right punctuations, and it also is able to detect this as an exception. Moving on to word tokenizers. These are the most commonly used word tokenizers, and all of these tokenizers assume that sentence splitting has already been done. So the input for these tokenizers will be a single sentence. Consider this sentence. It has username mentions and lot of punctuations and word contractions, hashtags and URL. And let's see how some of the tokenizers perform on this. Starting with simple split about all the white spaces. We get some tokens along with the punctuations. For example, the second one and third one, this will be problematic because in the next stage, when we will convert it to word embeddings, then these words won't be present into our vocabulary. And another reason for that will be they will be these will be treated differently in our vocabulary. This word with the punctuation and without the punctuation, even though it should be treated as a as the same ones. Moving on to NLTK's word tokenizer. Now this works better and works well on contractions, but doesn't work that well on URL. Splits it into 5 different tokens. Let's see how the multilingual tokenizer does. It works much better on the URL, but still is not able to detect the username as one single token. Now the casual tweet tokenizer, it works better on username and also on the hashtags and URLs. However, we can also know that the rules are different for handling contraction. For example, tweet tokenizer does not split at all about the contraction, whereas NLTK does split, and the multilingual tokenizer splits differently. Now let's see how well the multilingual tokenizer does on text other than English. So these were translated using Google Translate. And here is a tokenization for the translated text. And looks well, I think. And then for Hindi text. And again here it seems to work well for this as well. Moving on to Token Buffer API. So as we can note here, the nature of these three tokenizers are different. Maybe we would want a tweet tokenize which handles contraction the same as NLTK word tokenize. So we can create our own custom tokenizers. In word tokenizer, all these tokenizers have been created using the Token Buffer API. And for the Token Buffer API, first the string is converted into a stream, and then various lexers are used, and these lexers are non-regex based and high speed, and these are used to split about these are used to identify the right position to split the text, and each of these lexers returns true or false to indicate whether they matched or not. For example, if we want to split simply about spaces and numbers, so we can just combine it using the logical OR function. Here's one example. Let's say we want to split about URLs and spaces and phone numbers and characters. So first, there are two different types of URL lexers. Let's say we want to split about both types of URL. And we want to split about phone numbers and characters, and this is our sample text. It has a URL, a phone number, and a hashtag. So this is what we get as output, and it works well on the URL, and this entire phone number is one token despite it having white space in between. Little bit about how this function works. So most of it will remain same. The lexers will change over here. Your rules will be different here depending on what you want to split about. So first we are taking the input and converting it into Token Buffer API so that we can read from the stream, and we just loop till all the text is not tokenized, and finally return the tokens. And we'll talk about statistical and subword tokenizers later. Now moving on with word embeddings. First, what is wrong with one-hot encoding? Mainly two things. First is that with one-hot encoding, all the words are at equal distances to each other, irrespective of how similar they are in meaning. And secondly, depending on how large your vocabulary is, let's say 50,000, then your one hot vector can be 50,000 dimensional in size, which will become infeasible. These are learned representations of word, So words which are similar in meaning will be closer to each other in our high dimensional vector space. These can perform simple analogy tasks. Let's say buy is to bought and sell is to sold, the past tense of this word. And these word embeddings can perform these kind of tasks, simply taking this is our word and its relation to subtracting this word and simply adding this word. We will get a word which is very similar to meaning to this word. Let's go over one example with embeddings.gl package. First of all, we load the package and then we load the embeddings. Here again, DataDebs download manages the download. Next, we create a mapping from words to its index. And then whatever word we want, let's say we want the embeddings for the word Julia, then we can slice the embeddings table for that particular index. Or if we are working with batches, we can also use flux one out or one out batch. I'll discuss more on that when I discuss the code. Now let's move on to the neural network architecture. We have already discussed is word embedding. Now in our architecture, we will use two LSTMs, and basically an LSTM is like a state machine which has two vectors representing its hidden state, and one is for long term context and another is for short term context. And we extract the hidden state of the second LSTM and pass it through a linear classifier to get our output scores. Now let's go through the code. Now let's go over the code for sentiment model. You can find the weights and notebook for the model at this link. First we load the packages. Here is how our sentiment model looks like. There is a field for vocabulary and word embeddings, two LSTM, and this is the linear classifier and the index for our unknown word. Here's the function, it tokenizes and returns the one hot indices of the input string. So first it tokenizes using LLTK word tokenize, and then it converts to one hot. And for each word, it first checks if it's present in the vocabulary, otherwise checks for its lowercase word. Otherwise, returns as one hot for the unknown index. And here is the forward pass for the function. First, we reset the hidden state for LSTMs, and then we get the embeddings. These are sliced. So this matrix multiplication will be like a slicing operation because x will be a one hot vector here. And then we pass it through LSTM 1 and 2. And finally, we obtain the hidden state from LSTM2 and return softmax. Now we load our sentiment model. Here are some example sentences. So this will just tokenize and then call the forward function. So let's see how it performs. If the score is greater than 1, the scores will be an array of two elements. So the first one will be corresponding to the score of positive and second one for the negative. Sum of those two will be 1 since we are using softmax. And let's see, for this example it says it's positive with this much score, and for this it is positive with 0.99 score, and this is negative with 0.98 score. So you can play around with this model, it's there on the repo, and try out more examples. You can find the notebooks and model weights at this link. Let's move on to some other tasks and how the pipeline will differ for them. Consider this task, named entity recognition. The task is to extract the named entities from text. Named entities like person, organizations, or place, locations. And another way we can treat this task is sequence labeling, where each token is assigned one label. For example, Jim is one token, and this will be assigned the label person. Bot will be assigned bot 300 shares. All these four tokens will be assigned the label of other or because they're not named entities, and this will be assigned the label organization. Here is how the architecture looks like. The pipeline mostly remains the same. So here is how the architecture differs from, in the final stage, our neural network architecture will differ. We use word embedding similarly to the previous one, and character level representations are obtained using CNNs, and then bidirectional LSTM is used, and for the final decoding, conditional random fields are used. The advantage of conditional random fields over doing a simple linear classification is that the decoding will be done globally in this. Here, I worked on this last summer in Google Summer of Code. This model is there on text analysis, and you can access it through the master branch. We start with loading these packages, and next we instantiate the model, and if the weights are not there in your system locally, then DataDips will download those. Assume this sentence, and we can simply do an NAR on this by calling this function, and this will return a list of labels where one label will be there for one token. So what we want to see is that which token data is assigned to which label. That's why we do word tokenizers, tokenize over the sentence, and then we zip and then collect, so that we can see that here it predicts person for Jim, other for bot, and organization for these two, and other for full stop. A similar task is part of speech tagging, which is another sequence labeling task. You can call this simply by POS tagger. Again, DataDips will handle. And similarly, you can call this function. Here is what it predicts: proper noun for Jim, and verb for bot, 300 cardinal. And for these two, again, proper noun. This is annotated in Pentry bank format. Now for other tasks, apart from these, you could be doing NLP generation, text generation based tasks, or machine translation. One place where it will differ is architecture. If you are generating, then probably you will be using some kind of LSTM based decoder or maybe transformer. So your architecture will differ, your data set will differ, and tokenizer will depend on the kind of text you are dealing with. If you are dealing with casual, then tweet tokenizer is the one you would probably want to go with, or it will also depend on the language you are working in. Moving on to attention mechanism, if you recall, in our sentiment model, we were using two LSTMs, and we were only using the final hidden state from LSTM2 to classify. Instead, we were getting as output sequences of vectors, one corresponding to each word, and a better way would be for model to decide which of those words are most important, and accordingly it can attend to the important ones and classify. This was first proposed for machine translation, where they at each time step attended to all the words and the previous context to generate the next word. Formally, we have n vectors in m dimensional vector space. We calculate score by matrix multiplication. This is a scalar. We do softmax over all scores, they add up to 1, and for each of the vector we multiply it by its own score and add these up. Or in flux, assume 100 dimensions and we have 10 words. Vex is the output we will expect from LSTM2, and W1 is our matrix. We can get attention weights by doing softmax and matrix multiplication. And for each of the vectors, we multiply each by own attention weights and then sum these to get 100 dimensional vector. Moving on to transformer, these kind of models completely get rid of any recurrences, LSTM or RNN, and they perform all these attention mechanisms across all the words in parallel. We are only interested in encoder for now. We can use transformer layer from transformers.gl package by Peter Cheng, and instead of LSTM, we can replace it by this encoder layer, or decoder if you are interested in sequence generation. Now, we talked about rule-based tokenizers. Moving on to statistical tokenizers, these tokenizers learn on their own how to tokenize given an algorithm. These two tokenizers, WordPiece and BP, are in BP and Transformers packages. Tejas Vaithya, a GSOC student, is currently adding WordPiece tokenizers to wordtokenizers.gl, and it uses DataDepth to download, and it is able to successfully tokenize about Subword as well. Thank you.